Good morning. King Charles and his three siblings have walked behind the Queen's coffin as it passed through the streets of Edinburgh. Our reporter John Paul Gonzo joins us live. JPG, it was a touching and powerful tribute.
Lockie, good morning. Another emotional day here in Edinburgh as the Queen's coffin was taken from Holyrood House up the Royal Mile and to St Giles Cathedral. Along the way, tens of thousands of people lining the streets to pay their respects. And it was a very surreal moment as the Queen's hearse travelled through. The crowd fell silent. And what was clear was the deep admiration and respect that people here have for Her Majesty. Behind the hearse, King Charles, Princess Anne, Prince Edward and Prince Andrew. Prince Andrew was actually heckled during that procession. One man from the crowd screamed at him, calling him a sick old man. That man was dragged away by other people in the crowd before he was dealt with by police. After that procession, there was a vigil at St Giles Cathedral, the Queen's children standing around her coffin in a very emotional display. So this is the first time we've seen the royal family in public with Her Majesty's coffin, and certainly we did see a lot of that grief today. Before King Charles arrived here in Edinburgh, though, he was in London this morning delivering an address to Parliament at Westminster, and in that speech, he vowed to continue the selfless service of the Queen.
We gather today in remembrance of the remarkable span of the Queen's dedicated service to her nations and peoples. While very young, Her late Majesty pledged herself to serve her country and her people and to maintain the precious principles of constitutional government which lie at the heart of our nation. This vow she kept with unsurpassed devotion. She set an example of selfless duty which, with God's help and your counsels, I am resolved faithfully to follow.
So some touching words there from King Charles. We are continuing to see that outpouring of grief tonight. It's just gone 11 o'clock here in Edinburgh. We're outside St Giles Cathedral, and behind me you can see a massive queue of people. They are lining up. They've been lining up for hours to get inside and view the Queen's coffin and pay their respects. That queue stretches for kilometres throughout the city. I've been told by a police officer tonight that the wait time is 15 hours for people to actually go in and pay their respects. It will be open throughout the evening and into the morning, so people here in Scotland can say their final goodbye. Tomorrow, the Queen will continue her journey home to London. She'll be taken by the Royal Air Force back to London, accompanied by Princess Anne. Lockie.
And we've just seen some live pictures from inside St Giles Cathedral. People who've waited, as you say, 15 hours to say their goodbyes. John Paul Gonzo in Edinburgh. Thanks for your time. Prince Harry has shared a heartfelt tribute for his grandmother on his Archival website. Queen Elizabeth's service, he said, he read this statement, rather. He says, her unwavering grace and dignity remained true throughout her life, and now her everlasting legacy. We too smile knowing that you and Grandpa are reunited now and both together in peace. Signed off, Prince Harry. King Charles will travel to Belfast later today as part of the new monarch's programme of visits across the UK. 10 News First reporter Alice Hogg is there right now. Alice, there's been a huge outpouring of affection for the Queen in Northern Ireland.
Lachlan, that is the case as the King continues to continues with that morning tour with a planned visit to Belfast here in Northern Ireland. A mural here set up to celebrate the Queen's Platinum Jubilee has now become a memorial, with floral tributes taking over a footpath and a message board also set up so that people can leave their notes and special messages too. Now, as we understand, the King's plans are that he and the Queen Consort will travel here to Belfast. They'll be met by officials at the airport and then travel on to Hillsborough Castle, which is the royal residence here in Northern Ireland, and another site where plenty of mourners have been paying their respects to the Queen. And here's what some of them have had to say.
We've seen the whole gambit of her life before us, and she's just been an inspiration and a role model for everybody. She never courted controversy. She did exactly what she's supposed to do, the constitutional mullah. She was a beautiful, lovely lady.
She's just part of the family. That's who she was, wasn't she?
Always loyal, strong and loyal, no matter what. Didn't give her views on anything, just in the middle of everything.
Now, at the castle, their Majesties will be meeting with the Secretary of State of Northern Ireland before later on in the afternoon it's anticipated that they will travel into the heart of Belfast for a service of reflection on the Queen's life at St Anne's Cathedral. Lachlan.
Alice Hogg in Northern Ireland this morning. Thank you so much. Moving back home, and Victorian MPs are set to swear allegiance to King Charles III today. In a short while, members of the Assembly and Council will be re-sworn before a condolence motion at Parliament House in Melbourne. Yesterday, Premier Daniel Andrews, the Acting Chief Justice and leaders of both Houses of Parliament signed the proclamation. After the remaining bureaucrats are sworn in, the Legislative Assembly and Council will adjourn for 1 week as a mark of respect. They'll then return to sit next Tuesday, which is in line with the New South Wales Parliament. Moving to other news now, and state leaders are expected to demand the federal government extend its pandemic leave payments for as long as COVID-19 isolation is compulsory. The payments of $750 per week for people who don't have sick leave are set to end on September 30. When they meet the Prime Minister tomorrow, New South Wales Premier Dominic Perrottet and Victorian Premier Daniel Andrews will both argue the system should be extended despite the drain on both state and federal budgets. Counter-terrorism police have charged a 36-year-old Perth man they say posted extremist views on social media. Officers allege the content included comments to shoot up a school. Police raided the man's Wellard home and seized two gel blasters, as well as a digital device which allegedly contained information on manufacturing explosives. He's been charged with multiple terror-related offences. An inquest has heard police initially suspected the husband of missing fraudster Melissa Caddick could be responsible for her disappearance. Police body cam footage has been played at the Sydney inquest, showing officers questioning Anthony Colletti. The inquest has been told Colletti didn't report his wife missing for more than a day after she disappeared. Caddick is accused of defrauding friends and family of up to $30 million. One man has been arrested, but four others are still on the run after a vicious stabbing murder in Brisbane. A 23-year-old man was ambushed in the street outside a gym at Mansfield. The victim was trying to leave when his car was rammed by a Nissan patrol. He was then dragged out of the vehicle by five men and stabbed to death. Four of the attackers drove off, but one tried to run away. He was arrested several hours later, found hiding in bushes. Police say the motive for the attack is not yet clear, but they are investigating links to outlaw bikies. The attack was clearly captured on security cameras. It's D-Day for the Star Casino in New South Wales as it awaits to hear whether it is considered suitable to hold a gambling licence in the state. The findings of an inquiry into the casino will be released in a couple of hours. The Star requested its stock be placed in a trading halt on the ASX yesterday. As early reports began to emerge, the operator will be found unsuitable to continue operating unless it makes some big changes. A Russian-installed official in eastern Ukraine is claiming they have lost massive amounts of ground because Ukrainian forces are outnumbering them 8-1. Ukraine's army says it has reclaimed 20 villages in the past 24 hours. many of which have been littered with landmines. The major counter-offensive operation has reportedly seized more than 300,000 hectares of land in the northeast, while in the south, Ukraine officials say they are also gaining ground, retaking around 500 square kilometres in Kherson. On the back foot, Russian troops have left behind swathes of military equipment, including tanks. Their commanders have been launching missiles at lost towns, strikes which have killed civilians, taken out power plants, and cut off electricity to millions of people.